Hey guys, my name is Matthew, and today we're talking about this book. So, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe is one of the greatest books ever, question mark? According to a BBC poll, it is. The UK voted The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe as their all-time favorite book. The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe regularly moves forward in polls and in surveys as the greatest children's book of all time, the greatest children's book in the 20th century. It constantly tops charts for the greatest books just in general of the 20th century, and it's really just known as a great book. It's got simple words in it, it's easy to read, it's got a compelling story, and there's so much going for The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. This particular video comes from the perspective of someone who grew up in the United States, who read The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe many times in my childhood, but from a very young age, I started reading this book, and there are things that I didn't fully grasp until I spent time in the UK. That's what we're gonna be talking about today, are the things that that someone from the United States might completely miss reading The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe if you haven't spent time in the UK, if you don't understand what some of these phrases are, and things that just stuck out to me as I was reading through with my daughter. Of course, as I'm reading through with my three-year-old daughter, I have to stop every few sentences and explain something different to her. What's a wardrobe? What's a witch? And it's, you know, just constantly that piece. But it allowed me to take the time to really think about the things that an American may not understand about The Lion and the Witch and the Wardrobe. The first thing that really struck me when I was reading through The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe most recently was the setting itself, which felt so much more real once I understood some of the context of what was going on in the beginning of this book. Obviously, as a child, I just didn't grasp the significance of having to leave London. So the four children, the main characters, have to leave London during the London air raids of World War II. They're sent out into the country and they live in kind of this huge mansion for a time with this old professor. These events, of course, are based in real historical events. And I never realized how much they actually flavor the rest of the book. There are so many elements of the battle and the importance of good versus evil, and even some of the ways that choices are made in the book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, that are based out of the war that was going on. World War II was such a key event while this book was being written, 1950s specifically, that World War II was fresh on the minds of so many people, that the parallels there seem impossible to miss. Of course, the setting itself is the English countryside, and I also get a much better idea of what that is, what that means. We talk about the English countryside and a big house out in the country that means something different now that I've actually spent time in the country and I've spent time in some big houses in the country. I kind of get a different feel for what this book is, and the setting really hits me a little bit closer. The book is, of course, titled The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Of course, I know what a lion and a witch are, and I know what a wardrobe is as well, but I do remember when I was a child, I actually had to ask my mom, what is a wardrobe? Because I didn't know. Americans don't have a lot of wardrobes. We tend to have inbuilt closets. In fact, in our building codes, in order to classify something as a bedroom, we have to have a closet, like a built-in actual closet. And so wardrobes are not particularly common. Of course, some people have them. My mom actually had a wardrobe growing up, so it wasn't unknown to anyone, but we just called it a closet. We called everything a closet. And wardrobes are more rare in the States. And so the wardrobe itself may be a little bit unknown to American readers. It's a closet, but it can be moved around and can be moved from place to place, switched around inside of a room, and you hang clothes in it, or in this case, big fur coats. One of the things that stuck out to me most in this particular read through of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe was the fact that Tumnus, who is a fawn, takes Lucy to have some tea. And I remember as a child thinking it was the oddest tea that I could have ever imagined. Mind you, we didn't do a lot of tea in the States anyway, but I thought there was this weird tea party, and I'll read you the description. So the description of this particular tea is they had eggs, sardines on toast, buttered toast, toast with honey, and sugar-topped cake, but didn't even talk about the beverage at all. And for an American reader who's thinking about it, their tea party, they're thinking, wow, that is an enormous meal to just have like a tea party or something. Like, we just had no concept of what this is. Tea is actually, especially in the northern parts of England and other parts of the UK, tea is the word that they use to mean dinner or supper or the latest meal in the day, depending on what you call it. Whatever the evening meal is, or sometimes the largest meal of the day, is called tea. And in the States, tea is only ever a drink sometimes hot, sometimes iced, but it's never the last meal of the day. And so the tea is actually had twice during this book, and as a child, and actually up until I came and lived in England for a time, I had no idea that this was actually the meal that they had. He was inviting them over for dinner and not just to have a drink. The next thing that struck me as odd during this read through is just shortly after this event with the tea, Edmund actually comes to Narnia as well and encounters the witch, and she gives him something called Turkish Delight. Now, of course, at some point in time, I looked it up when I had read it as a child to try and figure out what this stuff was, but in my mind, it still somehow stuck that Turkish Delight is some sort of meaty dish, because it's described in the book as having pounds of this stuff called Turkish Delight. It was the most delicious and the sweetest Turkish Delight, and I have this thought in my head that it's got to be some sort of turkey dish or like a beef dish or something, and it's got like flaky layers, and I'm like, oh, it must be some kind of meat. And it's not. We were gifted Turkish Delight this year for Christmas, and it's candy, kind of. It's like sugary, gummy, way too sweet. I can't believe that Edmund ate pounds of it, because I have like one piece of Turkish Delight, and it's too much. It took us weeks and weeks and weeks to eat all of our Turkish Delight. So in this read-through of Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, not only do I know what it is, that I know it's candy, but also I'm aware of exactly what this experience was for Edmund, and he must absolutely love Turkish Delight if he was able to eat that much. Later on in the book, three of the children are traveling with the beavers, and they're going towards the stone table, and winter is starting to break. So it's starting to become springtime. One of the first things that happens before spring comes, though, is that Father Christmas comes to visit them, and he has wonderful gifts for them, and they have a great time. The reason that this is quite important is Father Christmas is not common at all in the United States. We always have Santa Claus. And the characters are very similar. They're both roughly based off of St. Nicholas, potentially. But this idea of Father Christmas being the character that an English child would be looking forward to is not particularly related to us. Of course, we know that there's a connection there, but as a child, Father Christmas was a new imaginary character in my mind. It wasn't the same imaginary character I was familiar with, Santa Claus. There are a couple cases where an American child reading The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe may come across words that they think are potty words or swears. Those words in particular are when the evil creatures are torturing Aslan before they throw him on the stone table, and some of them continually call him puss, 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 pussy, like over and over again. They're actually repeated words there. And in the context even, if you were an American child, you may not understand that that's just another word for like cat in England and in the UK, but actually those words are kind of offensive in the States. The other one, this is a bit more old-timey and less UK, I think, but the word queer is used quite often. A queer feeling, or I'm feeling quite queer about this. The children say it several times, and again, you may think that that was a naughty word if you weren't familiar with an older usage of that word. Another thing that I actually had to look up this time, because I wasn't completely familiar with it, was a saccharin tablet. Lucy hands a handkerchief to one of the giants at some point, and it says that to him it was the size of a saccharin tablet. And I was like, what is that? It's kind of an outdated form of sugar, or like sweetener. It's like 300 times the Swedish sugar, and it's a known carcinogenic now, so we don't use it very often. It is still available, but that was an interesting one that I actually didn't know in this read-through of Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe. The last thing is kind of a long list of all of the bits of language that stuck out to me as odd. There are two reasons why this language might be odd, and if you want to run in the comments and let me know which one you think each thing is, that would be a fun little task. But some of the language is odd because I'm an American. Some of the language is odd because I am not familiar with this UK language and it's a bit odd to me, and some of these phrases I'm now more familiar with. Some of these phrases are odd because the book was written in 1950, and that means that the language was just different. It was older language back then. Of course, both American English and British English have both evolved since the 1950s, and a lot of these words and phrases are outdated in either language. And some people will, of course, get mad at me for saying American English. It doesn't matter. I still said it. So go ahead and leave a comment below if you're angry about the fact that I said American English or British English. Here's the list of things that are a bit odd. The phrase good washout, make it packs, the use of the word pail instead of bucket, a jug of beer as opposed to maybe a pint or a mug, a marmalade roll. Peter says, couldn't we have some stratagem? whatever that is, a good step from here. Edmund wants to pay Peter out for calling him a beast. That's interesting because the phrase pay Peter out is a strange phrase, but also to call someone beast in today's language is quite a compliment. The exclamation poo is quite funny to me. I'm saying spectacles instead of glasses. The animal that I was completely unfamiliar with is catamountain. A sledge, of course, instead of a sleigh. Reach down that ham. The exclamation by gum. Curious feeling, which was used constantly in this book. She had, like, someone has a curious feeling all the time. An Alsatian, which is the name of an animal, actually, and it's the name of the dog that I would call a German Shepherd. I'm not sure if that's an Englishism or if that's an oldism. The witch removes her outer mantle. How beastly. And the last one is an interesting bit of grammar, a grammar lesson here. Mr. Beaver uses the phrase, "It isn't her," and the narrator automatically remarks and says, "This is, of course, bad grammar." And it's such an interesting phrase because for an American, I would certainly say, "It isn't her," and that would be correct grammar. But of course, for someone who's learned Latin and thinks of English in the terms of Latin, he should have used the phrase, "It isn't she." It isn't she, as opposed to "it isn't her." So that's an interesting one. I think that's also a bit antiquated and not so much an English versus American thing. Let me know if I'm right about that in the comments. I've always been quite fond of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and the whole Chronicles of Narnia, in fact. They're books that I'll be reading to my children, and that I hope my children will grow to love as well. There are so many fun things in these books, and my love of them has grown even deeper because of my time spent in the UK. Do let me know what you think of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe in the comments. Do feel free to like and subscribe if you want to see more content like this. We put out new content every single week, and we'll see you guys next time.